So I'm going to be doing my first water cooling PC. This is my system at the moment. It's a wall mounted PC that I built a few months ago. It's been working pretty well. It's fairly noisy because it's so close to where I sit and it's all open, so I decided a water cooling system might be a good idea. What I'll do first is take you in and show you around the components that are already on there to get a better idea of what's going on. So here we've got a GTX 970 by Zotac. It's a fairly good card, it's pretty small, it's compact. The main reason I went for this card is before I had this card I had a 7850 on the same build, and I had to kind of keep that within those dimensions because the mounting holes for the graphic card were already there. A lot of the 970s at the moment have this heat pipe thing going on up here. And it wouldn't fit on here, so that's why I decided to go with this Zotac card. Another reason was the Zotac cards have mounting holes on the back. I'm not sure why they put it on this card, and I've tried the Asus one, the MSI one, and they don't have these kinds of mounting holes on the back, so it makes it pretty impossible to attach it to a board like this. I've got a Corsair H60 water cooler. On the all-in-one units, and I've also got underneath there we've got i5-3570K, and that's running at 4.3 gigahertz, and I think it's a 15 millivolt offset voltage on there. It doesn't get massively hot. Prime 95 it'll go about to 75-80 at most. Really, it never really gets to that temperature normal use. It's been stable for probably about 6-7 months. It's pretty good. Here I've got a Silverstone small form factor power supply. It's 450 watt, which is just about enough for this kind of system. Having the 970 on there is pretty good for that because it's fairly low power. Hard drive, I've got a 256 gig SSD, mSATA SSD, that's mounted underneath the motherboard. And I've got two sticks of 4GB Corsair Vengeance RAM, 1866 speed. Something I forgot to mention is I swapped out the fan on this power supply. The stock fan was pretty loud, and I swapped it for a Noiseblocker. It's Noiseblocker NB Black Silent Pro fan. It's a thin 80mm fan. It's pretty good. Can't really hear it. The pump loud noise and the GPU noise is a lot louder. I've also got a Noiseblocker fan up top here on the radiator. It's a 120mm fan. Again, it's dead silent. Does its job, and I'll be using two of these on the water cooling build. So these are some of the water cooling components I'll be using. Here we've got a Alphacool 240mm radiator. It's 30mm thick. It's the ST30 full copper radiator, so it's a copper radiator. I've got two of the Noiseblocker fans that will go on there. Here we've got the GPU waterblock. This is one of the new waterblocks from Alphacool. The idea behind this is that this is just a heatsink that they cut out for any graphics card. You can get all the different variants, but the actual water block is this section here, and they just mount this into this heatsink. It makes it a lot cheaper and easier to produce the different card variants. So this wasn't too expensive. It was about £55, I think it was, here in the UK. It also comes with a back plate. I won't be bothering with a back plate. It doesn't really help for cooling, and it'll just end up interfering with my mounting system. Here I've got some Phobya right angle fittings, revolvable fittings, so hopefully they don't leak or anything, but I've got six of these, and I'll just be using those in the system along with the tubing. This is Masterkleer clear tubing. It's fairly flexible, so it should be pretty good. It's 12.7mm outer diameter and 9.5mm inner diameter. And finally, I've got the Mayhems Pastel Ice White Coolant. And it's a 1 litre bottle, and it comes with biocides and everything in there, so that's all you need, really. So I've just got the pump in. Looks quite nice. You can see it comes with various bits of hardware for different socket options. Also comes with thermal paste. It looks like quite a nice pump. It's quite big, but it should work. The instructions seem pretty good as well. These instructions seem generic for the all-in-one version of this unit. So what I'll do first is go with taking the GPU heatsink off and putting this GPU water block on there. What I need to do is figure out where I'm going to place everything on the existing mounting board. I'm hoping everything can fit on there. If I need to, I've got some more. That mounting board's made out of HDPE, high density polyethylene. If I need to, I can cut some more bigger piece and start mounting it on there. But I think I might be able to just get away with putting anything on there. So what I'll do, I'll get all the components together, unplug everything, and start arranging it and show you what I've done. So this is the rough layout I'm looking at. I've moved the power supply from down here up to here, and 180 degreed it. There's not as much clearance at the top here that I'd hoped for. I hoped it'd be a little bit lower, but it should be okay. I might redo the board at some point. This will line up with the graphics card and go right up to this fitting here. The cables, I hope to send the cables underneath the graphics card and the motherboard and then come out where they need to come out. So it might be a bit of a squeeze, but yeah, I'll see how it goes. The radiator will fit quite nicely here on the existing holes. I don't have to drill too many holes. Motherboard staying exactly where it is. I have this nice open space here as well. I was thinking maybe if this CPU water block res thing is no good, I'll get a separate resin pump that I'll put there. Something that's quite nice about this water block is it comes with these two fittings here. And they've just got a quarter inch thread on both sides. And that goes here. But you can actually just take it off and send your fitting straight into it. Which makes it makes this angle a lot shorter here, so it doesn't come out as far. So that's quite nice, and that really helps get just that much off. Otherwise the power supply would hang off the board. So it's quite good. So what I plan to do with the piping is have the CPU water block here. It will be pumped from the CPU to the graphics card, and the graphics card will then go out all the way along the bottom here, around here, into the radiator, and then come out the radiator and go straight back to the CPU block. So it's fairly short. Short piping, it's fairly simple, so shouldn't be too hard to do. You can see this is a pretty nice water block as well. It fit perfectly on this Zotac 970. I didn't bother going with the mounting plate on the back because I've got my own standoffs installed on there, and the mounting plate will interfere. The screws that they provide are designed to go through both the back plate and back plate. Their screws are designed to go through the back plate and the water block, so they're quite long. Obviously, because I wasn't using the back plate, I had to use my own screws. So I happen to have these nice black hex head screws, and I just used those. Happened to be a good length. Just screw them in until they hit the end, really, in a cross pattern. Another thing I want to mention is that the instructions for this water block are pretty good. A whole bunch of different languages. And it tells you exactly what you need to do. It comes with all the thermal pads and everything. Tells you what screws go where, and it's fairly straightforward. It must have taken about 10 minutes to install, and wasn't too bad at all. It even comes with thermal paste if you want to use that one. I decided to just use some Arctic Silver I already have. But it comes with thermal pads as well. It comes with one thermal pads for the top water block as well as the back plate as well. So there's some thicker ones for the black back plate here, and then these are for the memory on the top. So that's worked out quite well. Is these two fittings that were on the water block, the GPU water block, just over there. They just attaching them together has made this fitting clear that one, so I can send two pipes in the same direction over each other. So that's quite nice. Something I've noticed here is I was hoping to take the pipe from here down here along this channel and up to the GPU, but it looks like it'd be a bit too much of a sharp bend here, so I might have to get a few more fittings, maybe three fittings, so I can send it around, down, and that way. So I'll see. I'll play around the configuration, see what I can come up with. What I've decided to do is instead of mounting the radiator with the barbs facing up, face them down instead, and have the pipes go underneath the radiator out through here and into the GPU. So the pipe will kind of go like this way into the GPU, and then for the CPU will kind of come up like this. So I think that'll look a lot better. It'll be a lot cleaner. Also gives a bit more room underneath the radiator for airflow. What I'll need to do is get some more, some 30mm versions of these, so I can clear the height of these fittings. And then of course fans will just go on top there. You can see the height, the total height there will be about 8.5-9cm. So it really helps. So it should be a fairly low profile build. I'm expecting the highest point of the whole build to be the CPU water block. It might be quite high, so I'll have to play around with it, see what it looks like. I've also decided against sending these cables down underneath the graphics card and the motherboard. What I'll do instead is I'm going to tuck them down here, zip tie them, and curl them, really curl them around and keep them really straight across here. And then what I'll do, I'll send this pipe through into there, and I'll go straight along. These cables go to the CPU power here, and they're not quite long enough yet, so those I probably will send underneath, across here, and have them pop out here with an extender or something. These extra cables, these are to power the lights, some extra spare connections, and the graphics. I might have to shorten these out, but essentially they plug into the graphics here, so they'll probably come just pop out underneath or something. The PCIe extender comes out here, and it sticks out about to here because it's quite a big PCB here, and it goes underneath and it'll plug into there, so that much space is basically occupied. So all the cables that need to go underneath the graphics card will have to go under this part, because there's not much space down there. This is the PCIe extender I've been using. It's just a cheap extender off eBay, just uses ribbon cable. I was having some pretty bad noise issues, the card would glitch out under load and stuff, so I put this aluminium foil tape, it's sticky tape, onto here and covered it with just some normal sellotape to insulate it. So that goes underneath, and you can see it sticks out quite far here, but essentially that'll just plug straight in. So the cooler's installed, the CPU block. Interesting choice of hardware for the 1156 socket. You get these little clips that you push into the holes on the motherboard. There's no backplate or anything. So you push these clips in, and then you screw a little threaded rod into it, and then the cooler sits on that. So hopefully these clips don't just pop out. It's a little bit like the stock Intel cooler where there's no backplate, you just have these little clips that clip into the board. The next thing I'm going to do is wash out this radiator with a bit of tap water, shake it around just under the sink, rinse it out a bit so all the gunk comes out. Probably do this about 6 or 7 times or till it's clear water. And then rinse it out with a bit of distilled water, just put a bit of water in there, shake it around. And then what I'll do is install the radiator on the board and get all the piping done. So I've got the pipes in. I haven't completely screwed them in yet. Still got to put the fittings in, but this just is a rough fit. You can see it's pretty neat looking. Should look pretty good when there's white coolant through it. To cut this pipe, I just use a sharp pair of scissors. People online saying to use pipe cutters, but I found scissors works fine. Does a very clean cut, as long as it's a sharp pair of scissors. This is a half inch outer diameter pipe. So not the chunky stuff you can get, but seemed to be the most commonly used. Next thing I need to do before I sort out finish the pipes, I need to take the graphics card off and send this. This is the 8-pin CPU power over to this socket here. Originally I was going to come out through here, go along and then underneath and then come out through there, but I think that'd be a bit of a pain. So what I'm going to do is come out, come down, and then this way underneath the graphics and motherboard, and then pop out here. So I'm just cut. What I'm going to do is take off these connectors, take the pins apart, and solder some more wire on to extend the connector. Also, I've got the PCIe extender that needs to go there. So what I think, maybe these cables can go in between the two layers here or something like that, like this. So it should look pretty neat. Originally I was going to zip tie it down to the board like these wires, but I think I might be pushing the space a bit to get the clearance for this guy. So usually for these ATX connectors you need a special tool to take the wire off the connector. What I've found is you can use a little trick by using just an ordinary staple, and what you do is fold it into this kind of shape, just enough to fit on the outside of the connector inside, and there's two wings on each side of the connector, and essentially by pressing this down in there it will close those wings and then the cable should just pop out. So if I put that in here and then just push it, then pull on the cable. Sometimes it needs a bit of wiggling. It just comes out like that. So all the wiring and pipes are done. I've laid out some tissue to start filling the fill ports just here. I'm going to use a syringe, take some from the bowl and start putting it in. I've got bench power supply here, just going straight to the pump. So I'll turn that on and off as I start filling the res. So, yep, we'll see how it goes. So the res is pretty full now. I'm about to turn the power on. Just put the cap on here so it doesn't splash out. Right. Oh, and there we go. So that in there is where the water gets sucked into the pump, so I've got to keep it above that level for there to be any flow. So I'll keep filling this up and come back in a sec. So I've got the pump full now. You can see all the tubes are full. There's little bubbles coming out slowly, getting pushed out. So yep, I'll let this run for a little while, check for leaks. But yeah, looking good so far. So this is just underneath the radiator. This will be the lowest point of the system. This is the bottom, so this will be facing down. So you can see there's good clearance there as well. The pipes go round here. They're not kinked or anything, so this bottom pipe, the water through this pipe is going that way. It comes out through here into the pump, and then back around this way into the graphics. So that's down there to the GPU. So I've been filling it a bit more. I'll probably put quite a few of these in, probably about 8 or 9 of them. When I picked it up, sloshed it around the radiator, still had loads of air in it. this is a nice build. You can just move it around and get all the air bubbles out quite quickly. So I just put the cap back on and moved it around and keep filling it up. In case you're wondering, the fan's running at 12 volts at the moment. It takes 200 milliamps. It's quite loud. If you can hear that. That is fairly loud. That's louder than the GPU problem was having. But if I take it down to... So I'll put the camera down. That's 12 volts. 10 volts. 8 volts. 7 volts. And I think that's bearable. That's maybe a little bit less than the fan on the graphics card. And that's 5 volts. About 4.6 is where it'll die. And at 5 it starts up again. So it's probably been about 45 minutes since I started filling it up. I can't see any leaks anywhere, everything looks dry. So what I think I'll do, I don't seem to be able to get any more bubbles out of this. I'll put it up on the wall, put some towels down and stuff, and see if I can get it just to turn on or something. So I've got the system fired up. Only got one fan at the moment, still waiting for the other fan to arrive. Probably be a couple of days still, so not going to be doing any overclocking. I'm running that full speed at the moment. Water level's dropped a tiny bit, but seems okay. So I've just got open hardware monitor here. The GPU and CPU temps are shown. So the GPU at the moment is about 27 degrees. The CPU is hovering around 40, just under 40. So it's looking good so far. Still no leaks, which is good. So I've had Firmark running up to here. I've just started Prime 95 and it's saturated. I've got it on Prime 95 blend. The CPU at the moment is running at 63 degrees. Dropping up and down around there. The GPU is at 47. Remember, that's Firmark and Prime 95 running at the same time. That's pretty good. I wasn't too happy with the power supply orientation, so what I've decided to do is cut a new piece of HDPE, and I've just laid everything out again. So I marked all the holes, and it's a little bit taller than the old board you can see there. It's the same width. Actually, I think it's just a tiny bit narrower. But now this PSU is in this direction, so it lines up with the graphics card quite nicely. The radiator will go exactly where it was before. Go there. Motherboard will go in the same place, and the handhold cutout will be there as well. So not too different. So if you've never worked with HDPE before, it's quite a nice material. Especially if you haven't done much hands-on work like this, it's quite a nice thing to work with. Acrylic tends to be a little bit harder. You've got to be careful it doesn't crack. Acrylic's quite brittle. This stuff is kind of waxy. It's very difficult to actually break this thing. It's the same material that you get for chopping boards. I'll be using this hole saw to make these holes. And this works quite well. I'm using a wood drill bit with the pointed end to get the hole exactly where I want, and then I'm using a metal bit to expand the hole up to 3.5 millimeters for M3 screws. But they both work. You can use either. So the board's done. I'm going to start putting all the hardware on. Start laying all the components out again. So all the hardware's put back on. I've decided to raise the graphic card up a bit, bring it in line with the power supply, so it should look a little bit better. This pipe won't have to come up as much either, so that will go straight into CPU and it'd be less of a steep angle for that to come up. So we're ready to start filling it up again. You can see I've rearranged the pump, so now the output goes into the graphics card there, so that looks a lot neater rather than doing this thing. Everything seems to fit quite nicely. The power cable here should come out down this way, instead of up down the top. So it's good spacing everywhere. I've got this nice open area here, and here if I want to add any more features at a later date. So, time to start filling it up again. So the system's just started leaking from here. I left it running most of yesterday and today, this morning. It's been running for a good few hours, probably about 6-7 hours in total. It's leaking from this point here. It's very slow, it's just one drip every so often. I noticed it was dripping just a little while ago. So I'm going to have to empty the loop again, take this fitting off and see what's going on. So this is how I empty my system. I just put the straight fitting here with a pipe on there and just tip this into a bowl. It comes out quite quickly. This system's nice and light, so you can just move it around, get all the liquid into res and just tip it out. Doesn't take too long. So thankfully this has leaked just here. It's quite a good place. I don't have to empty the system too much. Maybe I've only taken this much out. So I can just lift this off and see what's going on. So I've taken both the O-rings off, I've dried them off. They both seem okay. There's nothing wrong with them. And they don't look damaged from over tightening or anything. I've just done these hand tight as I could. This O-ring goes in there. There doesn't seem to be any cracks or anything in there. There does seem to be a tiny bit of liquid just behind this gap there, but I suspect that was from when it leaked. It just got a bit of it in there. So what I'll do, I'll dry everything off. The fitting looks okay as well. There's nothing wrong with it. Looks fine. So what I'll do is I'll dry everything off. Reassemble it, fill it back up, and we'll see if it leaks again within a day or two. So what I noticed when I was leaking, there's a tiny gap just between here. The O-ring sits, half of it sticks out from underneath this fitting and half of it sits inside the fitting. So what I did, I just used a wrench with a bit of tissue around here so I don't scratch this, and just tightened it just about 2 millimeters of, you know, must have been a few degrees worth of turn, 5 or 6 degrees, just so that touches the bottom. I didn't apply very much pressure at all, but compared to hand tightening, a tiny little turn that seemed very easy with this. I think that's properly pressed the O-ring into position. Another thing, I'm not totally sure if this fitting reaches all the way to that the rubber O-ring in there, so hopefully I've pressed it enough that both of these make contact. Thankfully all my fittings aren't in too catastrophic of a place. These two, if they drip, they just drip downwards here. I noticed the drips on my desk, so that's okay. These two down here, there's no way they can touch any of these electronics. If anything, these would just drip onto my monitor, onto the side of my monitor. Hopefully it wouldn't do too much damage. The ones I'm worried about are these two. If these drip, that goes, it will either drip down here and into the electronics of the graphics card, or drip around the back, in which case I wouldn't see it. So I might just stick some tissue back there and check it every few days or a few weeks, just to make sure nothing's dripping. Started leaking again, so I'll take it off again and see what's going on. So what I've noticed is, this O-ring that sits in there, this fitting, I've taken its own O-ring off, and I've just put this one, the pump O-ring in, and I've screwed this all the way down. Now this hits the end, it hits this plastic, the screw hit this top part, hits the plastic, and the bottom must never be meeting this O-ring. So this O-ring doesn't do anything. So I'm going to have to figure what to do. See, so that thread isn't long enough to get to the bottom where it touches the O-ring and compresses it down.
So we're purely relying on the O-ring of this fitting, which should be okay, but I mean, this plastic bit around here doesn't look that useful, so I'll have to see.
So what I've done is I put both the O-rings back in, the pump one and the fitting one. I mean, I put some PTFE tape, some of this stuff, on the thread here. I've put about 4 inches on, I think. That might be too much, I might take a bit off, but I'll see how it goes. Looking online, people, this seems 50-50 on people who say you should and you shouldn't use it. Some people say not to use it on acrylic because it cracks the acrylic. Some people say you should use it on plastic, on a plastic thread. So we'll see how it goes. It might work. The only concern I have is if this isn't applied properly, when taking it off, bits of it could fall in there and end up getting stuck in the loop somewhere, which wouldn't be good. So I put it on quite carefully. I folded. The tape's quite thick usually. It's about that thick. I've folded it. I've probably cut about 4 inches off. Folded it in half and wrapped it all the way around quite tightly. Obviously in the right direction, so when I screw it in, it doesn't unravel itself. So I'll screw that in and see how it goes.
So I screwed this in quite tightly. This was with about 3 inches of PTFE tape. I screwed it in. You can see the threads have formed quite nicely there. So what I think I'll do is take this off, apply a fresh one, and put it back in, tighten it up, and start filling up the loop. I'm only wanting to see if that, when I take this off, whether anything falls into the system or falls into the pump. But it seems to have stuck on quite well, and it hasn't unraveled itself or anything like that.
So what I found is there's a tiny little crack just here running along the thread. It's not very long, probably just a couple of millimeters long, maybe even less than that. But that's where it's leaking from, and the crack goes all the way to the other side of the pump housing. I took this apart and had a look. Be able to see, kind of see it there. It's cracked. So thankfully I had the second pump, but I've put that in. I have to get rid of this one, this one's no good anymore. So I'm wondering how this would have happened. I don't think I over-tightened the fitting. Especially not, at least not initially. I only hand tightened them. I didn't do them that tight. They're easy to take off by hand as well. So I'm not sure if it's just defective or something that happened over time. I can imagine it, because yesterday was fine, all of yesterday. I can imagine the crack just developed overnight and then started leaking this morning. I don't think the PTFE tape would have helped with this. It would have made it worse, because it expands that out more. I don't really think there's any recovering from this. It's using some kind of I think this is polycarbonate. This doesn't look like acrylic, it feels like polycarbonate. There's some kind of cement that can be used to fill that back in and bond it together properly. I'm not sure how that fixable that is.
So I've got the second pump installed. Hopefully this one doesn't leak. I've only hand tightened this, so I haven't tightened them that much. I could probably undo this with my hand right now, but it's secure enough. Hopefully we have better luck with this pump than we did with the other one. So it's probably been about 5 or 6 hours, no leaks. So yeah, it was definitely that crack that was causing it. Thankfully I have this second pump. I actually ordered this out of just being impatient for the first one to arrive, because when I ordered it, it happened to be ordered from Germany, and I'm in the UK, so I ended up buying it from a UK source so I could get the project done within the same week, and this pump arrived a week later. So good thing I got this one. Something I've noticed is that this pump is a lot quieter than the last one. And what I did, I took the motor apart on both of them and tried to figure out what was making the noise. And this uses the ceramic Alphacool pump, the small one. And that it has a the impeller on it is this magnetic material, and what they do is drill the edges to balance the motor out, to balance the impeller. And it seems that the original pump, the impeller was balanced very, very poorly, and just turning it on with my bench supply when it was opened up, it would just vibrate like crazy. Whereas this newer pump, it doesn't. It's very smooth in comparison. So I think that was just causing the whole housing of the pump to rattle. Initially, I thought it was some kind of defect with the pump or scraping something inside, but there's nothing like that.
So everything has been running well for about a week now. Not had any issues, not had any leaks with this new pump. Temps are really good. Only thing I'm having trouble with still is the noise of the pump. So what I've done is bought some lead pennyweights. This is real lead. And something I've noticed is if I touch the side here, the pump noise dies down a lot. So there's a lot of empty space inside this filled with foam. What I plan to do is use some 3M tape to stick these lead weights onto the motor and the inside of this housing, hopefully to dampen the noise a bit. So I'm going to empty my loop again, take all this apart. Just need to take the pump off and drain it out. Shouldn't be too much to do. So I stuck all the weights in. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Seven stuck to the housing, one on the back of the motor, and I've got these two left. They are 14 grams each, so I'll stick these two in, put the foam in, close the pump up, and we'll see what it sounds like. So the build's finally done. I'm not sure how much of a difference the lead weights have made. I think it's worked a little bit, but really I could just be getting used to the noise and finding it less annoying than I did initially. Both fans are now on, so that the noise of both the fans as well might be covering it up. These fans are very, very quiet. I've got them running quite fast at the moment, but they are pretty good. When the machine goes under load, these speed up a little bit and then you can't hear the pump noise at all. So I think I'm happy with it for now. I might tidy these cables up, just tuck them down or something. But otherwise everything's done. It's got a little PWM splitter here. Back here I've got a little dial to this changes the pump speed. I can speed it up or slow it down. Still got a few bubbles working their way out. I might decorate this section here. 3D print a little companion cube, so I might 3D print a few of these different sizes and stick them down or something. Or I'll decorate somehow. I think I'll leave this space open for now, maybe leave it for another pump or res in the future if I decide to change something. But otherwise it's all done. Might add some lighting in the future. I hope to get another one of these PCIe extenders at some point and paint it white, because it's still grey and a bit of foil tape. But otherwise it's all done. So I hope you enjoyed the build. Any questions or comments, leave them in. On YouTube or Reddit, wherever you find this video. I'll try and answer whatever I can. And see you in the next one.